and welcome back to another Volcano 3 drum synthesis video. I'm going to attack the snare drum next, and once again I find I have a lot to say on the subject, so it's going to fill another whole tutorial. I'll start with white noise, as usual, coming from Reaper's stock noise plugin, then insert a volcano after it, and let's stop that noise by turning this default filter all the way down. Now we need an envelope generator, and we're going to start by switching it to trigger from MIDI rather than the main or sidechain audio inputs. Of course, that means you'll need to route MIDI data to an effect plugin, and every DAW handles that differently. But you should see a yellow MIDI activity indicator light up at the bottom left when you send MIDI notes, if you set this up correctly. Now we can modulate the filter gain with this envelope. If I set the modulation depth to 0.5, the gain parameter will be modulated back up to unity every time the envelope triggers. Now let's set the envelope parameters. I'm going to drag the decay and release curves to make them snappier. Then set the decay and release times the same as each other. Let's try typing 0.3 for both. Then drop sustain down to zero. And now the envelope behaves like a simple attack and decay envelope and ignores note off data, so the length of your triggering notes won't make any difference. And finally, let's set the attack time as fast as it will go to get a nice fast crack at the start of the note. Now we have a snare drum type envelope shape. Let's look at the filter itself. I'm going to switch it to a high pass filter to start with, which gives us something that starts to resemble the crack of the snare wires. And I'm going to dial in some filter resonance to generate a low fundamental as well. Snare drums are characterized by a low fundamental within a certain range of frequencies. 200 Hz is a good starting point. And this is sounding a lot more snare-like all of a sudden. But the precise frequency of this low fundamental makes a big difference to the sound. Tuning it higher makes it sound funkier. But if you go much above about 250 Hz, it ceases to sound like a snare drum anymore and turns into a kind of weird, noisy bongo. Tuning it down below 200 Hz starts to evoke big fat rock drum sounds. But when you dip below about 150 Hz, again, not really a snare anymore. That gives us somewhat less than an octave to play with, but we still have plenty of scope to tune that resonance to a note that works well in the key of the mix, which doesn't necessarily mean the root note. Let's add a MIDI modulator, set it to velocity, and modulate the main output level. And now we have velocity sensitivity. That was easy. Now, I have a couple of issues with the resulting sound. Most importantly, I don't like all this content above 10 kHz. White noise just keeps going remorselessly all the way up to Nyquist, in a way that real-world instruments never do. And to my ears, all that super high content sounds kind of plasticky and unnatural, especially in the context of a mix. But that's also easy to fix. Let's just add a low-pass filter. I usually set this somewhere around 10k, and sometimes I give it a little resonant boost to enhance the crack of the sound. The 12 dB per octave slope gives us a much more natural type of roll-off of ultra-high frequencies. But I sometimes switch to steeper slopes for a darker sound. The other issue I have with this type of snare setting is with the consistency of the low fundamental. You need to set the resonance carefully to balance that low note against the noisy crack. But the random nature of the noise input means that it can vary from hit to hit, and sometimes get a bit tubby, and sometimes a bit thin. It can help to boost up the resonance, then tame it with some extra drive. The saturation creates a kind of compression effect, as well as adding nice harmonics. And your choice of filter style will make a big difference to the result. But personally, I find the best approach is to crank the resonance up too high, so it's way too loud, but resonates consistently for each hit. and then use another high-pass filter to pull it back and rebalance it with the noise component. Okay, this is an acceptable and usable snare sound, albeit in a kind of vintage drum machine style. And this is, in fact, basically what I did in the Volcano 3 introduction video that prompted all the requests for a drum synth tutorial. But it's possible to go further and create more complex setups with more tweaking options. So here's an alternative starting point setup. This time I've got two filters running in parallel. Filter 1 is a band pass, self-oscillating at the fundamental frequency. And filter 2 is another band pass, but this one with much less resonance and tuned higher to evoke the crack of the snares. Both filters have the gains modulated again, but notice that this time they each have their own envelope. That's not making any difference yet, as both envelopes are currently set the same as each other. And they're both set too short as well, by the way, but we'll come to that in a moment. First of all, let's note that changing the balance between these two filters means adjusting the depth of gain modulation for each. That's not very tweaking friendly, and this balance is really important. So the first thing I'll do is add a slider to do this more easily. I'll link this to both the envelope modulation slots, and I'll invert the assignment for filter 1, so that turning up the slider increases the noise level while decreasing the low fundamental, making the resulting sound brighter. That way around feels more intuitive to me. Now I'm going to click the bottom corner of the slider and switch it to be bidirectional and produce both negative and positive values. And it now acts like a crossfader, with our original balance to be found at the center zero line. It's way too extreme at the moment, however, so I'll click the pin at the top to show the assignments again and set the slider's modulation depths much lower. And let's also give the slider a meaningful name, like tone. Next, I'm going to add two more sliders to control the decay of these two envelopes. The first needs to be linked to both the decay and release parameters for envelope 1, and likewise the second to both decay and release for envelope 2. And this time, I'm going to leave both sliders set to produce positive only values. That's why the envelopes were set too short to start with. That was the fastest setting I wanted available. Now I can turn these sliders all the way up and set the modulation depths to define the longest setting available. Don't forget to make sure decay and release are modulated the same, so our envelopes continue to behave like attack decay envelopes and note-offs continue to not matter. Now we have a slider to control the low ringing of the drum, which I might call boom, and another to control the noise decay, which I might call crack. And these can make a massive difference to the sound. Shortening the low fundamental is a little like adding more damping to the drum shell, which you could compensate for by increasing the relative level of that low fundamental. While adjusting the noise decay is a little like adjusting the tension of the snare wires for a shorter, tighter crack, or a longer, looser burst of energy. This is all good, but we still have a slightly naive, vintage drum machine kind of sound, based on a very simplistic model of what makes a snare drum sound. We've modelled the low fundamental explicitly with filter 1, but all the rest of the sound is just filtered noise. Now, the high frequency crack of a real snare drum is complex and chaotic enough that we can synthesise it with noise quite satisfyingly and convincingly. But a real snare drum will usually also have lots of other resonances, creating partials that are complex, certainly, but definitely not just random noise. If we were using a synthesizer instead of a filter plugin, then perhaps our low fundamental would be an oscillator rather than a filter, and we'd have the option to use a sawtooth or square wave instead of a sine. Or perhaps we could add another filter stage in series to distort the output of filter 1 and generate some extra harmonics. But there's the problem. Both these techniques would generate a nice, neat harmonic series, which sounds nothing whatsoever like a drum. What we actually need is a bunch of inharmonic partials, ringing at frequencies that are not necessarily multiples of that low fundamental. So let's add another filter. And I'm going to set the routing so that filters 1 and 2 are mixed together in parallel, then both feed filter 3 in series. And let me introduce you to the concept of an all-pass filter. So you know what a low-pass filter is, right? It's what ProQ3 refers to, perhaps more intuitively, as a high cut. And likewise, a high-pass filter passes the high frequencies unchanged and cuts the low frequencies. Well, an all-pass filter passes all frequencies without attenuating them at all. Instead, it just rotates the phase around the cutoff, as indicated by the phase plot that appears on the graph. There's been a certain amount of discussion on my own channel recently as to whether this type of phase shift is audible at all. It seems as if perhaps some people are more sensitive to phase shifts than others, or perhaps it just depends on the playback system. Anyway, I'm guessing that if you hear a difference when I bypass, it's mostly because I'm using one of the colourful filter styles, and we're still getting that tasty saturation. The fact that the all-pass filters do still include the non-linearities is very interesting, and I'm still exploring the possibilities that offers. But for now, let's keep it simple and switch to the clean style, so we're getting nothing but the phase shift. And I'm guessing you don't hear a difference when I bypass anymore, even if I increase the slope or add resonance. So next, I'm going to add an LFO, which I'm going to use to modulate the frequency of the all-pass filter. Because while static phase shifts may not be audible, modulated phase shifts certainly are, especially when you modulate at audio rates. Things really start to get interesting when the LFO gets up above about 200 Hz. And of course, the modulation depth also makes a big difference. Balancing these two parameters can create an infinite variety of different metallic shell resonances. And of course, you can also add more LFOs if you like. These can modulate the all-pass filter frequency again in exactly the same way as the first one, but at different frequencies. Or if you're feeling clever, you could use them to modulate the frequency or phase of the first LFO instead, and create a single, more complex modulating wave. Either way, the differences in sound that result from even very small changes in the modulation settings can be surprising and difficult to predict. It may take a little experimenting to find something you like. And when you do land on something close to what you want, Volcano's undo feature can become very useful. If a tweak takes you further away from whatever you liked about the current sound, it might be better to undo it and try again, rather than continue down the wrong path. Okay, I can't resist switching the filter style back to one of the colourful options. I just really love the saturation in these filters, which can make pretty much anything sound better. And speaking of which, of course, this snare sound is going to hit a compressor in the course of the mix, or more likely several compressors. And it's likely to get saturated as well, or maybe gently crushed with a sample rate reduction effect like the destroy style in Saturn. And it'll probably get some reverb too, even if sometimes that's too subtle to grab your attention. Okay, I've probably gone on for long enough again. Look out for the next part, where I'm going to talk about hi-hats and stuff. Thanks for watching.